treat P to multiply by the treatment rate for the treatment for people who inject drugs. The total treatment numbers are different in each scenario here. What we might normally do would be to set a set number of treatments, and that's a little bit more complicated, so I didn't want to put that into the code today. But basically, you can add or subtract a variable rate of treatment over time. Okay, so just to show you the rest of the next bit of the code, when you're actually running the model, you've defined your initial values, you've defined the model structure into a function as we went through, you defined what your parameters are and the vector, which is time. And then all you have to do is run this ODE function and it will give you the output. With a model of this size, it runs very quickly. Sometimes we run models with 800 or thousands of equations and they take a lot longer to run. And then just repeat with each of the different parameters. You can see that more explicitly in the code file. Okay, so the output that you get, I've also included in the code how I plotted this. What it's showing is the number in the compartment over time. So for death is over here in X people who inject drugs, but it applies to both equally. And essentially it's showing changes from susceptible to infected to cirrhosis to treatment under the four scenarios: no treatment, no not treating people who inject drugs, treating equally, and treating people who inject drugs at a higher rate. So we can see what the model is doing. So that's basically the model output bit. And then I just wanted to show quickly a very simple way of applying the costs and quality of life weights to those outputs. And so I've just assigned them to variables and then get the total treatment cost, also get the cost of cirrhosis and add that together to get the total cost. And then in order to get the quali weights, I've taken a vector here of quality of life for each of the categories and multiplied it, element wise down each of the rows and summed them up to get the total qualies in each scenario. In the code, I also have done a similar DALI calculation, just assuming inverse weights, but I haven't put that on the slide here. So if you're interested, you can look at that. Then quite easy to just add another column, which is the discounted values for the total cost and the total qualies. I've just written a very simple bit of, well, I mean, it probably doesn't look simple, but just calculate the ICER. So for within each scenario. So normally we might run this for a lot of different parameter sets, in which case you then have to, you have essentially a probabilistic sensitivity analysis built in and you would have to average over them. In this case, since we only have one parameter set, it's a lot easier. So we're just adding up over all the years and getting the dividing by the population size to get the per capita cost and outcomes. And sorry, this is an image which was pasted in, so it's a bit blurry, but just sort you, and you might have your own way of calculating ICERs or other cost effectiveness outcomes, other packages that, or maybe we'll learn about some more later in this workshop. But I've essentially just output a table which has the cost in the first column of numbers for each of these scenarios, the the qualities, and you can see that the qualities increase through these scenarios, and the cost actually it is cost saving, and some of these should be dominated. The most cost saving one is treating people who inject drugs at a higher rate, and that's because in this example model, all of the transmission happens in people who inject drugs, so we're preventing a lot of infections by doing that. If you don't treat people who inject drugs, you still have a benefit, but that benefit is due to preventing cirrhosis rather than due to preventing new infections. And then I also just cut it off at a 5-year time frame just for interest. And you can see that the outcomes and the costs are much less, and it doesn't become cost saving until later on. Okay, hope that made a bit of sense. I went through very fast, so I'm happy to take questions, but just wanted to emphasize that it's important to use a model which accounts for infectious disease transmission when you're looking at the interventions related to infectious disease where there's ongoing transmission. Here, treating the people who are involved in disease transmission makes the treatment cost saving, and cost and outcomes can be seen over a long time period. We could answer other things with the model, and I already mentioned that we'd normally allow for uncertainty in parameters. So I just wanted to present an example here. And here are some links to further reading if you're interested. Just to say very quickly that I preferentially use R, but sometimes I do make models in MATLAB because that's what my colleagues are doing, and it's easier to share code that way. But you can also do a model in MATLAB, which can be then compiled into C and run in R. So I've done model fitting in R using a model that was initially done in MATLAB. So just, you know, always trying to bring some way of using R. And also just to say that sometimes, even for an infectious disease, we do end up using a Markov model because the rate of reinfection is expected to be very low, or we're only looking at a particular cohort. So there's some decisions to be made there for each case. I think that I probably used up too much time to show the code, but I hope that what I showed you in the slides was enough to figure out how it goes. You should be able to just run straight through that that R file and reproduce basically everything I've shown here. So thanks a lot, and let me know if there's any questions.
Thank you, Josephine. Yes, I think we have two questions from the virtual audience. The first one is about why did you choose to model using ordinary differential equation rather than individual patient level model, which I think you kind of touched upon briefly. So the question goes on and says something about whether a discrete event simulation or agent-based modeling would have been better.
Mm-hmm. So thanks for that question. There are many ways to do it, and I think that when you have in some cases it might make more sense to use an individual based model, particularly if you're interested in a really wide range of differences between patients. But when using a differential equation model, I think it runs much, much, much quicker than an individual based model. So it's a way to incorporate transmission in a very systematic way that when you vary the parameters, you're sort of representing a wide range of who the patients could be without having to go all the way to using an individual based model, which is much, much more complex to implement.
Thank you. And then there's a very technical question which essentially asks how dissolver estimate the actual parameters of the differential equations and how efficient R is in doing advanced calibrations such as nether mid simulated annealing. And that comes from a Mathematica user. I know you mentioned MATLAB,
okay.
which is a different kind of software as well.
I've used R to fit parameters. But I wouldn't do that within dsolve. You would use like a least squares or a approximate Bayesian computation or some other algorithm to pick parameter values, which are then run through dsolve to, and return results, and then tweak the parameters, run it back through dsolve, so that parameterization doesn't it uses dsolve, but you need other stuff as well. And I'm sorry to say I don't know about simulated annealing, but I'm sure whatever you want to do, there's a big group of people using R for infectious disease modeling and parameterization and fitting. So I'm sure there's some information on that.
I mean, you probably need to complement dsolve with other packages specifically to do in the estimation of the parameters. Howard, do I have time for a short question or are we running too late?
I think we maybe have 1 minute, but yeah, we have 1 minute.
Well, maybe Josephine and I will take it offline now, because I suspect the answer will take a lot longer and the discussion.
Okay. Well, I'm happy to chat with anyone later on as well. Thank you.
All right.
Thanks very much, Josephine. So the next speaker is Devin and Surti. So Gianluca, I think if you set him as a co-host.
Yes, I think now you should be a co-host, Devin.
Devin, you can unmute yourself.
Yep. You guys are able to hear me okay?
Yes.
Perfectly well.
Awesome. And you guys can see the screen?
Yep.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for having me here today. I'm going to talk about multi-state semi-Markov modeling in R, but with a primary focus on its use for cost-effectiveness analysis and modeling. So at least from what I've observed, Markov models are probably the most commonly used models for economic evaluation of health technologies. The primary limitation is that it's difficult to incorporate history or time dependency, at least not really in a kind of an easy way. You typically have to create lots of tunnel states to be able to do so effectively. An alternative type of model is a semi-Markov model, which can actually model this time dependency in a very flexible manner. One perceived maybe limitation is that it, in most cases, does require individual patient simulation, which is both computationally expensive and can be complex to program. So because of this, we set out to try to create an R package, which is called HeSim, where we really wanted to do two things. We wanted to create a general framework that makes it easier to program and means you don't kind of have to build stuff from scratch every time. And is also computationally quick, so we can run things quickly to kind of get around these limitations. And then of course, we wanted to build it actually for the purpose of computing cost effectiveness and doing cost effectiveness analysis. So just a little background, what actually is HeSim? As I said, the main purpose is really to build simulation models and to use them for the purpose of economic evaluation. I think there's two key characteristics. One, we want to make it modular, which means kind of you want to put together a bunch of functions and classes together to build your models to try to give maximized flexibility for users. And then secondly, again, we wanted to make it fast. That was a key goal of ours. The package currently supports both cohort and individual level state transition model. Today, we'll focus on just the individual level. One of the keys to any model, of course, is how you parameterize it. So we wanted to allow someone to be able to to fit a model, either using an explicit statistical approach, say fitting a multi-state model in R, or maybe you don't have the data to fit something in R, you have stuff from the literature, so you could create like a custom parameter object based on literature estimates. And then the way we made it computationally efficient is really under the hood, all the simulation code is written in C++. So R is kind of like a wrapper for this core code, or an interface, if you will. We also wanted to try to represent the whole modeling process and kind of integrate it in the manner that you see on the slide here. So I think there's sort of two things to keep in mind. One, the modeling process kind of goes from starting with parameterization, then going to simulation, so simulating outcomes. And then finally, once you have those outcomes, can we actually use those for decision analysis, such as maybe a formal cost-effectiveness analysis? I kind of think of the first phase, parameterization. I think it's easy to think of it in like a machine learning framework, where you're kind of like training your model on training data. And then the simulation phase is sort of like prediction on some sort of test data. The second thing, at least in our HESM framework, any model is kind of consists of three sort of sub-models. And those are what are in the boxes here. So we always have a disease model for simulating disease progression, and then utility and cost models for attaching values essentially to the states simulated using the disease model. At least in my view, kind of the ideal way to parameterize a state transition model, if we have the available data, is to use a multi-state model. I mean, here on the right, we just have a very simple example, kind of a canonical reversible illness death model, where there's three health states, healthy, sick, death, four possible transitions. So patients can go from healthy to sick or back from sick to healthy, which is what makes it reversible. And kind of one of the key things about a multi-state model is we actually estimate explicit hazard functions between each of the different transitions. And we also do so in a way that properly accounts for the structure of the model. So we account for censoring and from any given state, sort of any of the possible competing states that you can go to. R is quite nice, obviously for statistical fitting, that's what it's meant for. It's no different for multi-state modeling. Typically, the approach you use will depend on two things. One, the data that you actually have, the type of data. And secondly, the type of statistical method that you want to use. Often the method that you can use is limited by the data that you have. So in the ideal case, we have what we have, I called here on the slides, continuously observed processes. That just means we have time to event. We know the exact time that event occurred. When we have that type of data, we can be quite flexible. So we can fit parametric or spline models. We can also do something like a semi-parametric or non-parametric model. I guess the Cox would be the example of the semi-parametric case. In other cases, our data is not quite so fine. We have something called panel data. So that would be like some sort of interval censoring. We know an event occurred between some interval, but we don't know the exact time. There you can fit exponential or piecewise exponential models. And finally, sometimes you don't have individual level data at all. You actually only have summary level data. In that case, we could do something like a network meta-analysis, although the techniques for multi-state network meta-analysis are still kind of still being worked out. They're not as established as some of the methods for individual level data. So one of the key concepts, I would say, in multi-state modeling relates to time scales. So in the kind of the classic Markov model, this is often referred to as a clock forward model in the multi-state context. And it just means that the hazard function is based on time since entering the initial health state. So if you look at the diagram on the bottom, a patient starts treatment at time zero. They move to the sick state at time two. They then go to the healthy state at time six, and they end up dying at time 14. So the clock is always moving forward. It's never resetting. In contrast, in the semi-Markov model, the clock actually resets, which is why it's called a clock reset model in multi-state language. And this just means that the hazard function is actually based on time since entering each state, and the clock resets to zero after each transition. So looking back at the diagram, the patient goes to the sixth state at time two, then the clock resets, It takes another four